Now, the October Revolution ushered in 70 years of communist rule in Russia and across vast swathes of Eastern Europe and Asia. Those events have shaped politics across the globe and are still used to define political allegiances and dogma. There were no cameras there to film the moment the Bolsheviks stormed the Winter Palace in St. Petersburg 100 years ago. But this is how the great Soviet filmmaker and propagandist Sergei Eisenstein chose to portray the events in his film October, 10 Days That Shook the World. And we can talk to Rob Griffiths from the Communist Party of Britain. He's in St. Petersburg. Thank you for joining us here on The Daily Politics, Mr. Griffiths. There were two revolutions in Russia in 1917, the one in February, a popular uprising which brought to power a socialist government, and the second, which was a coup, a putsch, the Bolsheviks, which was achieved by armed force and consolidated through terror. Should that be celebrated?
Oh yes, it should be celebrated because the revolution, of course, transformed the lives of hundreds of millions of people for the better over the following 60 or 70 years.
In what way did it improve it for the better?
Well, it provided education and health services for entire populations that hadn't previously received them. It gave them low-cost housing, public transport. It gave them science. It gave them great advances in just about every field of life.
But done against a backdrop of fear and punishment. The secret police were set up. Elections were pretty well all but abolished. Everything was done by force, wasn't it? Basically said it was our way or the highway.
Well, the strange thing is, can you still see me, by the
way? Yes, funnily enough, I can't now. You've just disappeared. Did you pull the plug there yourself, Mr. Griffiths? Can you hear me? No, I think we've lost Mr. Griffiths temporarily in St. Petersburg. I don't know what happened there.
I suspect it's... Well, of course, I mean, Putin and the Kremlin do not want to celebrate the Russian Revolution, so it's rather mysterious that it's disappeared.
Do you think so? Not just a power cut. Should it be celebrated or just marked, Rachel Shabby?
Oh, I think, you know, to have a one-note response to the Russian Revolution, to the October Revolution, would be wrong. It was so many things. I mean, I think I'm not about to celebrate, the violent, authoritarian murderousness of Stalin, but I'm not, because of Stalin, going to discount the hope and the cause and the popular uprising in which the October Revolution began. So I think it's a very complicated thing. Obviously, it has significance in lots of different ways. And, you know, it would be nice if we could explore all those different ways instead of just asking to be put in one or another of categories.
But it was a regime of terror, wasn't it, to a large extent. So, I mean, in the end, did the means justify the end?
No, of course not. No. But that doesn't detract from the how it all began and what the sentiment that began it was, and the defiance and actually the audacity of what they pulled off in those early days. I don't think there's an inevitability to it, although that is something that historians are very much still discussing. I mean,
but what it began with was Marxism, which is one of the worst ideas in human history and has failed everywhere. Has failed everywhere it's been tried. Of course, the cry of the far left is always, well, it's just never been tried properly. I mean, well, it's been tried and is responsible for the deaths of 100 million people, potentially. And I think it should be seen, I mean, it shouldn't be commemorated, it shouldn't be seen in terms of being marked. It should be lamented in the same way that we lament the Holocaust. It is one of the great catastrophes of human history, and it unlocked the door to tyranny, to the gulag, to an extraordinary degree of repression, and the price was paid across across the world by the victims of the communists.
I mean, do you think the victims of the gulags, of the camps, of the purges, in some ways they are underplayed because of the horrors of the Second World War and the Holocaust? What happened then afterwards, once the Iron Curtain had fallen and before? Do you think that has been underplayed in history?
I mean, I'm not about to start, for obvious reasons, I'm not about to start comparing, you know, the October Revolution to the systematic extermination of 6 million people. Has it been underplayed? I think all sorts of things are now being re-emerged and rediscussed. But what I wouldn't want to happen is the sort of predetermination of a historical event with an ideology. So Marxism was bad, therefore everything was bad, therefore everything about the revolution was bad, I don't think is a particularly helpful analysis of what happened.
But it's the root of it, and the root of the Marxist analysis is essentially the abolition of the basic means of exchange, the junking of the market system. Now, what then happens in every case where this is tried, which is that those who then object to that economic analysis must be contained and ultimately cracked down on. This is why it happens every time to varying degrees, because it has at its root a false historical economic analysis, which is a catastrophe, and it has never worked anywhere.
Well, there is a rejection of a economic system, capitalism, that doesn't necessarily lead to authoritarianism, which is what you're implying.
Which is,
I think,
of course,
that is a very naive analysis.
That is why what's happening now in the Labour Party is so significant, in that the democratic socialists and the mainstream left, who have always controlled the Labour Party and took the decision in the 1920s to make Labour a parliamentary force rather than a revolutionary force, did something so important and patriotic, which is why the Labour Party has been throughout its history until now a mainstream bulwark against the far left.
So, just to be clear,
for the first time in its history, the Labour Party is now being controlled by the far left and by people who regard the Russian Revolution as a cause of celebration.
You're saying, just to be clear, that the people who are now in the Labour leadership, they're pretending to support the NHS and free tuition fees, but actually they wanted to get into government so that they can overthrow government, i.e. themselves. They want to overthrow themselves. That's what you're saying.
I think what's most interesting...
Doesn't make any sense.
Well, it's how the Bolsheviks operated, if you look at the history of the Russian Revolution.
But these are self-proclaimed democratic socialists. The clue is in the name, democratic socialists, parliamentary system.
They're not.
They're not.
The people around...
But in your opinion...
The people immediate, based on the evidence, the people of their association with the Communist Party of Great Britain, their writings in defence of Stalin, their defence of the October 1917 revolution. There is a very smart group around Jeremy Corbyn, much smarter than the Labour leader, who have taken control of the Labour Party. This is a historically significant event. And I think what the danger then is, and what worries mainstream Labour people and mainstream Labour voters, is that if they get in, What then follows is that governments can actually do quite a lot without legislation. You can do quite a lot with emergency
power. But why are so many people voting? Why are so many
people
voting
revolutionaries
for Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party?
I said that a small group had taken control.
And do you think that, Rachel? I mean, the idea that there is some revolution being planned around Jeremy Corbyn, that he is surrounded by people who would like to see something much more extreme than socialism.
I think that's conspiratorial to the point of hysteria. I mean, look, we're not even talking about state ownership. This is a party that clearly supports a mixed market. They support an increase in taxation for the very highest level of earners in society. They support some renationalisation of utilities. They support investment in the welfare state. None of these things are revolutionary.
Do you think there have to be capital controls?
By what definition?
So just, when there's
no,
a run on the
answer,
country, when
don't
wealth...
Answer the
when,
question with when, another question. No, do you think any of those
leaves,
things are revolutionary?
When wealth leaves the country, when essentially everything which isn't nailed down flees, do you think John McDonnell as Chancellor would have to introduce capital controls stopping money leaving the country?
Do you think that getting the levels of corporate tax to the levels that currently exist in the rest of Europe would cause businesses to flee the UK?
Or even as they are now.
And if so, to where?
I, I think the cleverness of the manifesto, and McDonnell is a very smart guy, and that is a really rather brilliant document, to con people in that way when you just have to look at what he said before he was Shadow Chancellor. Asked who his greatest influences were, he said Marx, Lenin and Trotsky.
Just one final question briefly, fascinating though this discussion is from an ideological point of view. Rachel Shelby, can you name a successful Marxist communist regime that exists today?
No, I mean, I'm not talking about even, I'm not even saying that this is support for communism. We started talking about what can we take away from the Russian Revolution. Now, one of the things you could take away from that is that you know, people who believe in supporting workers' struggles might choose to do that through parliamentary means, through democratic socialism. Mm.
Okay, and then finally, on that, do you think by using your critique of the October Revolution, which you say should be lamented, it's actually unfairly stained the credible cause of socialism in many people's minds?
No, I don't think it has. I'm really old-fashioned. I just want the proper mainstream democratic socialist Labour Party back, the party of John Smith, of Gordon Brown, of Tony Blair, and for once the far left has managed to steal the Labour Party.
You supported the Labour Party then, did you, Ian?
I was raised in a Labour household.
All right, let's leave it there.